solve little problems right away than getting stuck at some point. So for today, I will give you an introduction to the Unix operating system. It will be not in too much detail, because otherwise it will be overwhelming anyway, and it will be sort of restricted to the regular commands that you would need in order to be able to go around on a Unix file system and do little things. So in order to do that, I have some exercises that will be listed here so that you will be able to run yourself on your own computer. So therefore, you will need to be able to have a terminal window. So for those that have a Mac, that's easy. You have a terminal window, you just open your terminal. For those that have a Windows machine, I don't know, is there anybody with a Windows operating system? Yes. So normally I asked Professor Jimenez to ask you to install Cygwin. Did you install that software to have a Unix-like operating system on your Windows machines? Do you have it? So you can already start it up? Okay, so then at least that's... By informatics, we're using Unix as the main operating system. There are several reasons for this, and one of the big reasons is that it's free. So certainly for academic world, that's sort of an important thing. The first Unix operating systems were developed already quite a long time ago. That's when I was born. And it was developed originally at the Bell Labs, where they were developing the first mainframes, big computers. And they had to develop this because the operating system is the layer of the computer that interacts directly with the hardware of your computer, so that you don't need to program hardcore assembler in order to access the mouse, the screen, etc. So the operating system is the layer that basically gives software the access to the hardware of your computer. And therefore, every computer and electronic system needs to have an operating system, an OS. So, and among those OS, you have Unix, which is the oldest sort of operating system. Mac OS is actually also a Unix-based operating system. That's why basically you didn't have to install anything special on your Mac, because it already uses Unix. Windows is a weirdo. This one is completely different from any other flavors. And Linux is actually the Unix for Intel CPUs. And so all those computers needs to have this. And as I said, it's your desktop computer, your laptop, supercomputers, clusters, even your tablet, your smartphone, they all have such an operating system. Although Windows is a bit of a weirdo in the list, because it's completely different from the Unix-like systems, it's the most dominantly available operating system on the market, which is sometimes annoying, I would say, for bioinformaticians, because many companies like Illumina, Oxford Nanopore, BioNano, etc., that produce machines to generate data and to do experiments, all have their software on a Windows system. Because the data that needs to be processed is actually oriented for the bioinformatician, and they don't want to have Windows. So that's why Windows is a bit of annoying. But anyway, so we're working on Unix, Unix-like, or Linux. And actually, when you even look at the US big departments and even in Europe, all the big servers, they're all running on Linux, because it's an open source operating system. It's reliable, more reliable than Windows. And I don't know if you heard lately with the latest Windows 10, with all those security breaches and it's spying on you and stuff like that. Basically, when you have the Linux system, because it's an open source system, everything can be checked. So the whole code is available. Everybody can check. And if there is anything that would sort of allow outsiders to spy on what you're doing on your computer, basically it will be removed very quickly. Except if you install software that actually allows this. So as I said, you have an operating system, and typically Android that you have on many smartphones is also a Unix-based operating system. The iOS is also linked with the macOS, and then Ubuntu Touch is not very popular, but that's also a Unix-based operating system. So, at the very beginning, when they were developing those operating systems, what we saw, what you saw then, back then, is that there were many different types of CPUs. There was not only Intel or AMD and so forth. There were RX systems and other different types of CPUs that all had their pros and cons. But as in the early times, until, let's say, even middle of the 90s, end of the 90s, you could have a lot of different machines, and each machine had its own hardware and therefore its own operating system. So you had different flavors of Unix in the beginning. And when you look now, you go back to the more actual world, most of the CPUs are now Intel. So most of the servers are running on Intel CPUs or AMD, and those two are compatible, but they all will be running Linux. One other thing is that Linux and Unix systems are basically programmed in the C language, so when you go really down in the code, and that gives an portability, because you can recompile that code according to your CPUs, and then you need just to have a compiler that can compile it for your specific hardware and CPU, and then you can have that same Unix system on more diverse machines. The big advantages, certainly compared to Windows, although Windows tries to do it also, is that Unix, from the very beginning, was a multitasking operating system. That means that you can run several software at the very same moment. If you look at whatever is running on your computer right now, you will see that you will have a whole list of software that is running. It can also allow multiple users to connect, and it uses time sharing. Time sharing means that every software will have a little time slot to run on your CPU, and basically the operating system and your the kernel of your operating system will allow you to will allow the software to basically switch between the different software, so that each software can run a little bit further. Now with the more modern CPUs, you have even different cores in a CPU, so which means that you can have even bigger time slots for each software. And if you don't have too many things running, basically one software can have a complete core for itself. Other things is that everything on a Unix system is sort of a file. A directory is a file, basically list that contains the listing of the files in the directory. And in that sense, also your screen or printer is sort of a file, and it's a sort of a complete hierarchical system. But don't worry too much about this. This is like a little bit going too deep in the Unix system, so don't worry too much about this. It's easier to use than it actually sounds like. But anyway, because it's using a sort of hierarchical file system, it also uses plain text, which makes it easy to configure and to store data. It can also, and then because it's all open, You can exploit the different pieces of the of the operating system and the little software programs that come with it in order to produce even bigger programs that can do even more complex things. So an operating system is composed actually of many little things that can build up bigger things. And when you're working or you're using a software, like in bioinformatics, basically you add an extra layer on those many little software. So like I said before, your software, so basically the gray box would be your operating system, where you have your hardware. The most important part is the kernel, and that one is directly connected to all the hardware and basically orchestrates the whole interaction with the hardware. And then on top of this, you have more user-friendly little softwares and applications that you can use that will use the kernel in order to access the memory and other hardware pieces of your computer. Unix, from the very beginning, has always been developed for developers. So it's lots of things are just command line and with very little graphical user interface, certainly in the beginning. Don't forget that at the beginning, in the 70s, 80s, actually you didn't even have a graphical user interface on your computer. Everything was done command line. Even simple printing was sort of like programming. With the time, actually, people got to develop things, more software, making all sort of things more user-friendly, adding little pieces of software just to operate or to interact better, in a more easy way with your printer, for instance. That was all possible. Also, because it was an operating system for developers, most of the languages that you use to have for developing software tools is already integrated in your operating system. So the C programming language is for a large part already present there. Perl is already present very often. Python, not necessarily, but it's easy to install. And with all those different software, developing languages, also came a lot of compilers, and again, those compilers are used to give access to the computer, gives the software access to the computer. Because it's a hierarchical system, the very nice thing is that you can build on someone else's developments. So that's why in a Unix system, you have a lot of libraries, C libraries, Perl libraries, etc., on which you can build your own software. So that reduces a lot your own development time that you need to in order to have some software. This is like a typical little window. I don't know if you can read it. It's maybe a bit dark. But basically, this is what you typically see when you have a terminal window and when you type a couple of command line. So like here, we have pwd will tell you where you are. What else do we have here? We open a file which contains some information, etc. Don't worry, we'll go over all those things later on. The big advantage of command line and disadvantages. So basically, the big advantage is it's simple. You don't need very much. It's easy because you can use it also over remote connections. Because it's easy and light, it also doesn't use too much bandwidth. Connect to a remote server. It's quite flexible. You can use many options and so forth. It's quite powerful. You can have scripts that loop through things, so you can do things in batch. You can even set a certain time when something needs to be executed. And you can, by piping things together, you can put a lot of things one after the other, basically exploiting directly the output of one program in order to further process it in the next program. The disadvantages, of course, command line, that means that you need to know all the options of each of your commands, which sometimes is quite a big list. Not that you will use them all the time, but can be sometimes a bit cumbersome. While the graphical user interface, the GUI, basically through buttons and etc., allows you to more easily browse and try out things. Of course, here also you need to memorize which button to click in order to do some stuff, so it's also something that you need to know. And very often, behind each button, there's quite a list of options, and those are not necessarily known to the user. So it's a bit of a cryptic. But another disadvantage, maybe, for the command line is that it doesn't forgive. I mean, it doesn't forgive. If you do something wrong with your command line, the computer will not know that you're doing something wrong, and it will execute it. If you do indeed something wrong, it might have kind of serious consequences. I can give you a very simple example, the command rm, remove, and you just put a wildcard star, and you press enter, and all your files are gone. And they're gone. You cannot recover them. So you have to be careful. So it's powerful, but you have to be careful with the power that you have at your fingertips. So think before hitting the enter. Okay, some brief history. So I already said that it was developed in the 60s. The two main developers were Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie from the Bell Labs, like I said before. They wrote the whole operating system in a C language, but C language and an assembler, so very close to what the hardware had. And it's actually with AT&T, so the big communication company from the US, they released a Unix system, and that they were actually even providing the US government and important ministries of the US at that time for their for the machines. So the very thing of the Unix system is that it's open source. I said before, the code is available, so you can see what it does. You can actually change it at any point of time. And because it was open and free, it was distributed very early to all the universities also, and mainly in the US, which led to different flavors of Unix. And one of them is like the Berkeley software distribution, more well known as the BSD. And that's also the basis of the Mac OS X. It's also derived from the BSDs, so basically the Berkeley software distribution. Also, because it was so popular, other companies started to pick on those, and so you had the Sun or IBM or HP that all had their flavor of Unix on their system. But not everything was perfect. Because as the companies understood that the Unix system was quite powerful and that it was used by many universities and more companies, is that companies started to produce software for their operating system, on the operating system, or complete operating systems. simply different flavors. But as it is written in C, you can compile it. And they only started to distribute the C compiled software. So basically no access anymore to the code. You didn't know what it was doing. And because of that, certainly in the academic world, people got frustrated because there were sometimes nice softwares, nice developments, but you couldn't play with it anymore. They were locked, completely locked. And therefore, like here, Richard Stallman resigned basically from his position and started to develop a free operating system, and basically he started the Free Software Foundation. And that led to the what is quite well known is the GPL, so the General Public License. And so most of the software that is developed in academic world is now distributed under those two associations and license. So that gave a new sort of rebirth to the Unix system, and chased away all those companies. Thank you. To keep the whole software and everything back again for free. Like to give you an example, a lot of companies and also our lab, we're using Red Hat. Red Hat is one of those many flavors that you have of Linux, but because it's a company and the company needs to make money, what they cannot do anymore because of those two licenses is that they cannot sell you the software. And because they cannot sell you the software, you have complete access to the software. But the only thing that companies now have to actually still make money using the Unix and the Linux software is to sell service. Basically, you have a hotline, and they sell you a hotline in order to help you configure your system and keep your system up and running. So the GNU, so the license under which a lot of software has been developed, is you will find it everywhere. So basically, this and the license, like I said before, so the general public, it's a derivative of the general public license. But so that means that every code here, if you publish some codes with the GNU license, you will be able to use other software that was published with that same license. And if you use that license, you have to actually release also your software under that particular license. This is a sort of condition to make sure that it doesn't die by basically everybody uses everybody else's software and then closes everything down. It's not possible. If you use some software that was available under this sort of license, you have to release it again under the same license. That gives you a guarantee for open source. And in that package that what you have with Unix, you have the GNU compiler, GCC, which is a very popular compiler that basically almost everybody uses. That's the only way they can make money, in order to help you when you have a problem with your servers. So again, why is it so popular also for bioinformatics? It's because a lot of what we're doing is dealing with sequence. And sequence is actually text. And text, basically, you can easily manipulate with software. And that's also why languages like Perl are very popular in bioinformatics, because Perl, when it was developed, had nothing to do with bioinformatics. Bioinformatics didn't even exist when it was developed, but it was aimed at manipulating text. So it has, with regular expression, you can actually look for very special patterns. You can do some formatting. You can easily manipulate text type delimited files, sequence files, very, very easily. And then, because also in bioinformatics, we now more and more dealing with big data, we need to have also a very reliable system, a system that we can expand. So that means have an ever-growing cluster, having large data files. Also, in a Unix system, it's no problem to open a file which is 5 gigabytes. Try this on a Windows system and your Windows machine will crash. So it has quite powerful possibilities. So this was sort of introduction to the Unix system. So now we're going to have a little look at a few commands. So we're going to start to play now a little bit. So for those that have a computer in front of them, they can start. And while I'm going through the slides, you can try those things a little bit yourself. Basically, this is what you would have. You would have your screen, and then you open a terminal. Or with Cygwin, if you click on the Cygwin, you will have then a black background with green characters normally. That's the default. If you can open this. When you see things coming on the screen, feel free to test them out while I'm talking. The command line is typically divided in a number of, in three basically packages or groups of things. The first one is the command itself. Then you have options that are typically with a little dash in front, so this a little minus sign. And then most of the time you have the files on which it has to operate. Important is that white spaces are important, so you have to separate your different elements in the command line by a white space. And also it's case sensitive, so you cannot use capital letters, mix capital with small and so forth. So it's very important. So basically here, again, this is working with computers, and computers are dumb. Actually, they do what you tell them to do. So the smarter the person sitting in front of the computer, the smarter things the computer can produce. Also, so the spaces are important. Exceptions on the options, sometimes you can put them together, but that we'll see after. And so basically, you type this sort of command. Okay, file one, file two, you will not be able to find it on your system, I guess. So that will not work. But if you leave away the file one and file two, you will already see on your terminal window what it gives. So, and in order to, once you're happy with the command line that you typed, you just press enter, and that says to the system, execute whatever has been typed there. There's also another way of giving options is to use the long name options, and this is with a double dash, so two times minus, and then you can say like here, ls space minus minus help, and then you can have some information. Also, which is very nice, is that a lot of, basically all the commands that are part of the distribution come with help. So if you need to find out what an option does, if you need to do something special and you need to find what option to use, you can always use the help. And it comes under different flavors, but we'll see that afterwards. So another, now a few things that you can try yourself. So there's a very easy command called echo, and you can type this, for instance, and then you will see what happens. And normally you should get what's just beneath. Also, if you're working on your computer, and you want to know who is working on your computer, who is connected, you can try the command users, and it will list the nicknames of the people that are connected on your machine. Of course, in your case, it will be only you. If there is someone else, you have a problem on your laptop, because that means someone else is basically connected to your computer. Also, something nice is who. And then it will tell you who you are, on which system you're connected, and at what time it is. And so it can give you information about the system. And then I don't know if this will work or, well, it will not be very informative, but if you see, for instance, here, you have a list of nicknames, and you want to know who is GMR, or here, Urban, basically you can do finger, the name, and it will give you some information. So in this case, you can use your own. When you do the users, you will see your nickname, and then you can try this one and have an idea of what's happening on your computer. And okay, maybe here on your own laptop, those things are not so useful because you know who you are and you know what you're doing, etc., etc. But once you're connected to a server, this can be sometimes informative. Certainly, if you want to know how many users are on the computer to see whether it's not too much use, then you might want to go to see whether there's another place where with less users in order to run some bigger software. Some commands, and okay, I would say don't do this now because it might mess up a little bit your system, but some commands are also interactive, which means that if you type this, it will ask you questions and you have to answer those questions. Typically, this command is in order to change the password on your system. So if you do this, you will change the password on your system. So this is maybe something you shouldn't do right now. So leave that for now. But actually, you also have some interactive commands. Also, when you have very long command lines, and then you read it again before hitting enter, and you see you have a little mistake that you did. You don't want to go with on the arrow, like clicking on your arrow and things like that and moving around, because you cannot click with your mouse most of the time. It's not that you can go with the mouse somewhere, click there, and the cursor will be there. You have to basically go through the whole line and move the cursor position by position. But in order to make it a little bit more easy, you have those combinations, so the control key with E, A, L, or U, and this allows you to move at the very beginning of the line, at the very end of the line. If your screen, your terminal is a bit full of all sorts of things, you can use the minus L and it will give you clean a bit the screen. And one very nice thing is that you can use the tab key on your keyboard. And that one will do auto-complementation. That means that if you were typing a command and you have, it's a bit of a longer command and you want to be a little bit lazy because computer programmers are, if they can be a little bit lazy, they will try to be a bit lazy. You can actually auto-complement, and that means that as soon as you have a unique set of characters, the beginning of the command line, you can do with the tab, and it will basically fill in the rest. This way, you don't need to type every command. Sometimes commands can be long, so that's sort of easy. Okay, so a few more commands that can be useful. Who am I? So if you have some existential problems, you can always ask the computer who you are, and it will tell you who you are. PWD is also quite useful. Will tell you in which directory you are. So if you're moving from one directory to the other, at some point you might forget where you are, or if you want to move around, you need to know where you are in order to move to the next place. You have a command date, will give you the date. So these you can all try out now on your terminal. Also, if you want to have some more information about your own personal computer, the laptop you have in front of you, you can try this one, uname minus A, and it will tell you the name of your computer, what sort of CPU it has, since how long it was running, and what other things are running on your system. If I'm going too fast, let me know, because I see that in the back you're trying it out. So another very much used command is ls, And basically ls will list the files you have in your directory. So it comes with lots and lots of options. And for instance, what you can try to do is to do an ls/bin, and then you will see the list of all the little software that you have. Don't put a sleep. Sleep is one of the commands, but just load without a sleep. And then it will list a long list of all the little software that you have on your system. And sleep will be one of them. And then you will have, basically you can try all those kind of things. Again, if it doesn't exist, it will complain. It will tell you this type of file doesn't exist. So if you do this, like here, lsbin, you will have this sort of listing with all the little programs that are part of your operating system. And some of them we've seen already. So you have the echo, date, what else did we have? Well, basically the list is long and I couldn't put it everywhere here. Also, in the very beginning, I talked about how dangerous sometimes Unix can be. And one of the dangers is that you can use wildcards. Wildcards are typically a star or a question mark. A star means any character and as many as there are. Question mark is for one single character. So in this way, you can substitute some characters. If you want to have, for instance, all the executables that starts with an L, you can do ls/bin/L*, and it will list you only the executables in the bin directory that starts with an L. And if you do it with a question mark, it will only list those two normally. So we're just an L plus another character. Some more options now. We're going to see a few options with ls. So you have ls-l, and you can do it again in the same directory. But here you can put a sleep or any other command if you want to see. By the way, sleep just tells how long the computer needs to wait. And this is what you should get, something similar you should see. And here you will see who's the user, in which group the person is, how big the file is in bytes, and when it was stored or last modified. And then here you have some privileges, some accesses that you can have depending on the user, the group, or the world. But I'll come back to this afterwards. So here, another option, it's the minus H. And here in this case, you can concatenate the different options. If you have single letter options in with ls, you can concatenate them. And so basically L will list you the same thing as before here, but H, and that's true for many of the command line programs, H, if it's not help, will be human readable. So that means that it will make this number here human readable. So this is 22 kilobytes. Be careful, a kilobase is, in informatics, is not the same as a kilo in other. So it's not a multiple of thousands, but it's 1024. So it's a little bit different. But the nice thing is that, as a bioinformatician, if you have a FASTA file, I don't know if you know FASTA files, the number of bytes is more or less the same as the number of base pairs, more or less. So it gives you sort of a hint on how big the sequence is, for instance, in your FASTA file. But that's more like a coincidence than actually something that was intended. Another thing that you have in Unix is hidden files. And typically hidden files start with a dot. So if you do now in the same directory, in your home directory, where you are probably now, you do this ls-a, and you will see that you will have a lot of those little files and directories that are actually hidden. And those are very often files that are configuration, like typically this bash profile, or config, Those are configuration files, and this one too here, that will tell the system what sort of environment you like, what sort of areas you want to have, etc. So, and while the other are directories very often, and in those directories, the software will actually put some configuration file in order to run. Or it can also be considered as a sort of directory where, like a bit like cookies, where basically the software knows what the status was when you left the software, so that when the software opens again, can it open with the same configurations and same settings. So to sort of make the user's experience with the software a bit more more pleasant. Another option is the -D, and that will only list directories. So the first letter in this string here will be a D, and it will only list all the directories that you have in a current directory. Sorry, miss, you don't need to take pictures. You will get the slides afterwards. Don't worry. So you can take have everything at the end of the. And maybe we can distribute it, print it, or as a PDF or something like that. Okay, so I said you have this ls, you can have different options. So the -l is to list with more details, a is to give you all the files, or including the hidden files, t is actually a way to sort the listing of files, so give it a try. So you type it this way or this way, both is the same in this case, and then it will list all the files in your current directory according to time. You can also use, like, it's not here, a big S, and then it will sort all the files according to the size in bytes of all the files in your current directory. But of course, if you use something which doesn't exist, it will complain. So just for yourself, maybe try to try this ls minus minus help, and then read or just quickly browse through all the options that you have, and you will see there are many. And many are in order to sort different ways and so forth. Sorry. Okay. So also, what you can do if you have many commands and you want to keep it sort of clean for yourself and readable, you can use the backslash. So that means that you can use a command line, and then you say, well, I have different things here and I would like to keep it sort of more clean and readable for myself. Then you can use this backslash. Basically, this backslash is as if the line is telling the system that the command line simply continues, and it's not a return or something that is being introduced here. Also, you can use several commands on a same line and by separating it by a semicolon. So this way you can do several things at the very same time. But more fun is when you start to redirect. So you have the bigger than sign, the smaller than sign, and next slide is with the pipe. So that allows you to actually write the output of one command in a file. So give it a try here, the same thing as here. And then you can use with another command called cut, but you can also use more or less of this text file. And this way you can actually redirect everything you were reading in a text file. And for instance, this is very practical. So if you have a lot of FASTA files, for instance, and you have one sequence in each FASTA file, you can do basically with an ls, you can say, list, give me basically in an other file, the whole list of all my FASTA files. so that you don't have to sort of copy and paste this to with editors. And you can use all the commands to actually sort them by time, by size, and everything. So that makes it easy in order to make a little file that contains all the files you want to process, for instance. If you use the cat, then you can sort of take the content of this and a bit. I didn't put it actually here, but you could say cat, and you could have this list of FASTA files, for instance. If this contains the list, a list of FASTA files, and you do it this way, it will be too complicated. I need to add more pipes and stuff like that in order to make it good. Anyway, so with this one you can see, but you will see that's also a little bit differences in between those three software, so cut, more, and less, typically, and give it a try to see the difference. I'll wait a minute while you're doing it. Typically, cut will show the content of the file to the screen all the way down. It will go through the whole file. More will actually stop as soon as your screen is full. And then you can use the spacebar or the enter key to actually move with the spacebar a next screen, or with the enter key line by line. And this way you can go through larger files. Once you want to go out of this, you just type Q, and then you leave the more. If you do this with less, and the big difference is that with more, whatever you were seeing will remain on the screen. If you do it with less, it works the same way, but once you quit, basically what you were looking at disappears, and you're back where you were before you opened the file. And then, so there's bigger than and smaller than, allows you to actually redirect the file or the content of files to different things. So basically here, you tell to read the content of this one with this software and to output it to this one. Other things is that you can combine different command lines, like again, and this is now with the pipe character, so the straight line. I don't know which sort of keyboard do you use here, American keyboard, or do you have an Ecuadorian? You say? The words, you mean the first letters? Okay. Because typically, also because those operating systems, programming languages, they were all developed starting from an English background. It's much easier if you have an American English keyboard. Because then all those characters are basically there right away. And if you use like a German keyboard or a French keyboard, you sometimes need more fingers on your hand in order to access some of those keys. So that's a reason why, for instance, I don't have a Belgian keyboard, I have an American keyboard. Okay, so here again, so basically this typically will list again the contents of this directory, and less will make it pageable. So basically that you see the first page and then you press on space and you get the next page. And you can also sort in between. So you can make a lot of combinations, and then referring to the previous slide, you can actually get the list of all the executables in the bin directory, sort them alphabetically, and then redirect it to a file, and so store it back again in a file. And what you can do then, a next command, is wc. And if you do wc without any option, It would tell you three different things: the number of characters, the number of words, and the number of lines. If you put the minus L, it will just tell you the number of lines. And this way, you know exactly how many little executables you will have in your bin directory. And again, you can combine both. So you can do this same ls, instead of storing it in a file, you can pipe it right away to that software that will process it and do the counting. But as I said before, Unix comes with a lot of help. So that means help is basically built in every command. And it's with different flavors. Sometimes it's just minus h. Sometimes you have to use the dash dash help. But you also have man and info. So those are four different ways in order to get more information about each command line. So, and very important here is read the manual. Basically, those are sometimes very short manuals, and it will tell you how to use it. And always, always, always read the manual. Before you do something, read the manual. Because, as I said, Unix systems don't forgive, so if you do something wrong, you might basically mess up your data. And you don't want to mess up your data if you had to pay a lot of money for this. If you do something wrong, you have the FASTQ files from your sequencing, a genome, or whatever, and you do something wrong with one of your commands, suddenly your file might be empty. And then you lose everything. And then you hope that you have a backup somewhere else, and that you can keep on working, but if not, you lost everything. So you have to be careful in this. If you're working on a good operating system, or a good system which is well administered, you might have snapshots and some backups running overnight and things like that, so that you don't lose everything and that you can go back from the stuff of the night or the hour before, for instance. But be careful. And again, read the manual. There will be lots of things in there that are useful. Here again, man from manual, and here also you can get a lot of information. Typically, man will give you more text information. The minus h, minus help, will typically give you a sort of summary, very short, telling you the little details. The man page will give you really a text, like a full manual of everything you do. And my manual pages come for each command in the operating system, typically. And it's quite elaborated because you have a name, you have a synopsis, so the general syntax, a full description with all the possible options and how to use them, with lots of text to read, on which sort of files it works, and what sort of other commands are related or can be combined with that particular executable, and it also typically gives you some example how to use it. So certainly if it's the first time you use a command, rather go for the man pages than for the info, because then you will have quite a lot of information. The help would be just like a sort of quick reminder in that case. And this is so basically how it looks like. So we saw the command finger, so that's what it's for. This is how to use it, but typically between square brackets you have the options in order to see things, and then you have a description and a long list of options. So given that man is the higher level manual page of the whole operating system, you can really go all the way up and have basically all the general commands, all the kernel calls and so forth, even how to use some games and how to run some games, because most of the operating systems anyway come with some rudimentary games. The fourth way is info, and that can give you again some more. It's sort of in between the simple help and the man pages. Okay, This is an example on how the info pages start. And now I have some exercises for you guys. So have some fun. And so you can basically do all these in your terminal. And then, meanwhile, I'll drink a bit of water. You can try, see how many people you have on your computer from what you remember. I don't know. I just give it to you like this. Just give it a try. Anyway, you will get the slides back again at the end of the course so that you can go back and forth and look it up. It's just a little challenge for you to see whether you actually follow the little. So, what is the complete path? What was the command again? Remember? Just wave at me once you sort of don't know what to do anymore. And then I go to the next page. With a lot of those things, there's many options or many solutions, let's say, to find the results. BWD. BWD is for number two. Yeah, you just type user. You just start users. PWD. So here you can use the uname or info. So here you can see what your system is. So basically, this number four was a hint for number three. So here again, with a finger, you can do this. And again, six gives a hint for what five should be. And you can, so here there's a return to images. So it should be who. And then here, basically, again, the hint is somewhere in the next version. Okay, next. And after that, we can have the drink. Well, there's still one page more, and then we have the drink. So here then, you will have to find that file. So with the previous one, here you should know where it is. And then
check the size. Here, it's the same command as the previous one. Here, a hidden file with a minus, with a dot. So that's an option that you need to use. With the ls command. So this you don't have to execute it. That's just something orally that you can say. So yes, we can concatenate.
We can concatenate the
different options. So here, this is by redirecting. So you have, on the previous slide, you had a way to see which are the users, and then you redirect it to a file. So redirect, this is with this character. And then, one thing I forgot to say is when you use a single character like this one,
it will redirect the outputs to a file. But if the file, again, it's Unix is not forgiving. So if you use a single, it will create the file and write in the file. If the file already existed, it will be overwritten. So again, very dangerous. If you use two of those characters, it will be appended. So that means that the file would not be overwritten, it will be added. So this is a very important little thing that I should have stressed more, is that there is a difference. So if you want to have the listing of one directory and add it to a file that's already existing, use this. If you use that, the previous content of the file will disappear. Here, this is basically the vertical line, the pipe. And here again with the pipe you can combine and you use ls on those directories and you combine it with this one. And the last. So here, what does it mean, this option? How can you find out what this option means? So basically that means you're going to look for help if you don't know. Or you're going to look for the man pages or the info.
Now in this part we're going to sort of browse through your system. And as I said at the beginning, the Unix system is a hierarchical file system. And so it's always important slash. Slash is basically where everything starts. If you do cd slash, the command is cd slash, but we'll come back again with little exercises in the next slides. Then basically you're at the very beginning of your whole file system. So everything starts from there. Typically now, if you didn't use the command cd ever, you will be in your home directory. And you will have this directory home, and then if you have a system with different users, there will be a user, basically, which will be you. And in this, you will have all the directories that you created, or that were created with the systems and the software that you installed. Next to this, you have very typical directories like tmp, temp. This is typically a directory which is used by the system to temporarily store some files in order to be able to work. User is for software that you installed by the user, is most of the time put in this particular directory, and this is for some sort of more exotic software. And other things that can be stored. And there's many more directories at this level. And typically, those directories, you have a number of them that are used to store executables. We've been looking at this bin directory already for a few times, or the user bin, and this is typically the place where you have the binaries, so the compiled Unix commands. In sbin or user sbin, you will have system administration commands. In the etc directory, you will have configuration files, like for passwords and other things that you might do. The slash dev is typically for everything you want to attach to your computer. So that means in the directory, you will see the name of the hard disks, USB keys, and all those kind of things will appear and will be mounted in this directory, will be installed in this directory. Then you have, of course, every one of those software depends on other software, on other libraries, and those are typically in the library, and in the same way as it is here, in user library, and then you have even some more other files that are then in a binary form in Cluj. If you know something about C programming, you will know that a lot of programs start with this include and refer to the libraries that you want to have in your software. So, and they will typically be in this directory. And also the man pages that we talked about previously, they are also here and stored all in this directory. Then here, I already talked about a few other directories. So the temporary files, typically some software might have to generate a little bit of data to write it down on some place to do something else with it in order to process, and then basically discard it again. So very temporary files can be stored in there. Typically when you want to also process large files, larger than that the memory of your computer can handle, it might put temporarily some binary files in this particular directory. That's why, also depending on systems, you might want this directory to be quite large, depending on what you're doing. On a normal system, it doesn't need to be large, but if you start to work with big data, fast view files and other huge files, you will need a bit slightly bigger. And then, yeah, you have variable parts. This is typically all the little software that is linked to a certain flavor of Linux and can be in there also, like a mail software or some software to print and so on. The home directory, this is your home. This is the place where you are. Normally when you log in on your system, and then you have other programs and libraries on this. So, this thing that we see here, up to this last slash, is called the path. It's actually the rules the system needs to follow in order to find a particular file. So typically this is like the streets. You can compare it with a city and with street names. So you have a cross, or you have, let's say, the city center, and then you take a street user, you have a cross, and there you take the street share, you have a cross, you take the street man. And this way you find your whole way through the whole system. And LS basically will tell you all those kind of things. We talked already about this PWD, telling you where you are. And then what you also have in a Unix system, and when you did an LS minus A, you will have seen that at the very beginning, you have a directory called one dot, and you have a directory called two dots. The one dot means here. Two dots means one up. So if you're in a certain directory and you want to have look what's one up, you can do an ls dot dot. So you can give it a try and do it from where you are, do ls dot dot, and you will see that you're looking in another directory than the one that you're in currently. So for paths, we saw PWD, that's where you are. And then typically here, those three commands are actually the same thing. So that says in this directory. So basically, if you go, if you're in that directory and you type this, you will get this list. If you type it without this dot slash, you get the same thing. If you're in whatever directory and you start from the beginning, all the way down there, you will again get the same thing. So all those three give you the same result, but depend on where you are on the system, will give you will work or not. So in order to navigate in the system, the important thing is cd, current directory. So if you type pwd, normally you should be in user home or something like that, something similar, or home and your nickname. If you do cd user share, you will move to that directory. And this way you can move around in the whole system. If you do a CD with nothing behind it, automatically it will bring you to your home directory. So there where you will start when you're looking. So that can be sort of convenient. There's also one thing I should have added here. It's also convenient is CD and space and a little minus. Just a little minus, and that will bring you back to where you were before. So if you do, you try now, type just CD. So you will be in your home directory. Then you do CD user share. You will do an LS to say where you are. And then you will see a list of files. Or you can do the pwd, and then you will also have a confirmation that you're in the directory. And then you do cd, where could we go? Cd slash tmp. You do again an ls. It's all nice to be able to go around in directories, but sometimes you have to create a new one because you have new data and you want to make a directory called new. Basically, the command is mkdir new. This will create a directory in the directory where you are. So hopefully you were back home in your home directory and you created a directory in your home directory. Also, if you do this in a directory where which is owned by the root user, so basically the system, you will not be able to create because you don't have write access normally in those directories. So you have to be in your home directory, and there you're only master in your home directory. Everywhere else, the system has more power than you have. So we create the directory new. If you do an ls, you will see that the directory new is in between the files you have in the home directory. You can create also multiple directories by just listing with a space in between all those directories in one go. If after this command you do an ls again, you will see that the new is there from this time, and the new 1, 2, and 3 will be also there. So those are all four directories that you create. But it's also possible to create directly a tree, basically a whole path to a certain place, by adding the option minus p. And minus p means to also create the parent directories. So basically, if you do this, it will create the directory 3 with inside a new directory called new in one go. And this way you can create a whole path to something nice. You can create, basically you can create directories sort of in advance before you're running some software. So suppose we created those two directories. So basically it will create here it will create the directory 3. In this, create directory 1. And here, it will create the directory 3. But as it is existing already, it will only create in the directory 2. So basically, it will not overwrite an existing directory. If it already exists, nothing happens. It will just creating the directory in the existing directory. So if you done ls, you will have where is it? Oops, I forgot to list it. So it will be in the list here somewhere. If you do an ls3, you will see that those two directories that you created are in there. But of course, it's very nice to be able to create directories. At some point, you also have to remove directories, because you cannot keep on creating, adding more data, more files, your system, your hard drive will be full. So you can remove directories. And for this, you have the command rmdir, remove directory. This only works on empty directories. If there are files in the directory, it will not work. So, for instance, in the beginning we created the directory new. We didn't do anything in the directory new. So if you do an ls, there's nothing. And then you can easily remove it. If you want to do the same thing with the directory 3 that we created, it will complain. Because there are two things in there. It's not empty. And this way you prevent from deleting things too easily. But again, if you use wildcards, you might remove more than what you want. So in the case that you have directories that do contain files, you can use the general rm. And this one is to remove files. Remember, the whole system, Unix system, is everything is a file. Also a directory is a file. So that means that with the rm command, you can also delete directories that contain files. The only thing you need to add is the minus r. And the minus r is to say to do it in a recursive way. So that means it will go in the directories, remove each file after the other until the directory is empty, and then only remove the directory. But instead of having to do this one after the other, with this option, you can actually do it in one go. It's much quicker. But again, be cautious using. So rm is the most dangerous, one of the most dangerous commands on the whole system. Okay, so also one thing that you very often want to do is copy one file to the other. If you want to process a file and you want to like make a backup of your file before actually playing with it, it's not a bad idea to make a copy of that file and put it somewhere else so that it stays safe. And typically to copy, the minimum is that you have an original file and a destination file. Like here, we made at the very beginning, we made this file, and that was by redirecting the ls to this file. So we have this file. If you want to make a copy, and you may invent or add a suffix to it to tell that it's a backup. And this way you can actually copy one file to the other and you will have a backup. And you can then mess around with this particular file. If something goes wrong with that file, you will always keep a copy of the file. One thing I should also add is when you add here suffix, in Unix system, a suffix means nothing. It's just for you in order to say, well, to give a thing a name. It's not like in a Windows system, and to some extent also in the macOS, is that this extension is linked to a software. In the case of Unix, this is not the case. So every text file can have whatever extension. If it's a text file and you want to open it with with a software which can open text files, it will work, no problem. There's no problem here. So you can give it whatever name that makes sense for you. So if we made a copy, you do an ls, well, you will find both files. You can also copy a file to another directory. So here we can do the copy in the same current directory. You can also make a copy to another directory. And this way, for instance, we want to copy the command ls to the current directory. And don't forget, dot means here, where you are. And if you do then an ls, you will see that this executable that was here in this bin directory is now also in your current directory. More copying is, so you can also copy one, more than one file to a certain destination. So you can have, it basically, the last word here is the destination. Whatever is before are the files that you want to copy to that destination. So here, with this command, you want to copy the ls and the cp to a directory called rom. But okay, it's called rom because it doesn't exist, so it gives you an error. So it doesn't work. If the directory exists, then it will work. If you made a directory, whatever, .o, your home directory, you will be able to copy the files from the bin directory ls and from the bin directory cp to this. If you do an ls of those, you will find it. So this way, you can copy things from one directory all the way down to another directory. And again, you can do this with wildcards. So let's say we make a program, a directory, which is, we call a probes program, short for programs. We do an ls with all the executable that start with an l, gives you this and this and maybe more. If you do the cp with this, the directory, you will see that only the command line, the commands that start with an l will be copied to that particular directory. So here again, wildcards can be used, and again, be cautious with the usage of wildcards. There's an option here also, mice r, and here also it means recursive. So you can do an ls minus r from a certain directory, and then it will list you the directories, the files in the directories, and then the subdirectories with the files in each one of the subdirectories. So here you have also something. And so if you copy, I forgot about it. So if you have this whole system, you can also copy a whole directory. If instead of copying a file to, from one place to another, if the name of the object that you want to copy is a directory, you will be able to copy the directory from one place to the other. And as the copy contains, as the directory contains a whole bunch of files, the whole set of files that were in the directory will be copied. So if you would do a copy of this to someplace else, basically everything that is in that directory will follow. So it will make a complete recursive copy of your directory. Besides copying, is to make backups, that's nice, but to some extent, if you want to work on the data, sometimes you just want to move it and not copy it, because certainly when your files are large, you don't want to have your system be basically full of the same file. So then you can move, and the typical command for move is mv. So short for move. And this way, and move works in different ways. Because here, in this way, move is used to rename a file. Because you move basically one file from one location on your hard disk to another location on the hard disk. And while doing this, you give it another name. And the old one will disappear. So this way, you can change names of files. If the destination is a directory, it will move that file to that directory. It will put the file in that directory. And of course, you can combine the two. You can copy or move a file to another directory and give it already a new name, another name. So you can combine all those things together. And as you can rename files, you can also rename directories. Again, directories, files, everything is a file, so you can change names of all those objects in the file system. And here are already a few examples. So give it a try. Well, some of them maybe not so easy because you don't know the name of those directories, but look around. Use the cd command, use ls, look around. Explore, don't be scared. Here also I'm talking about relative paths. With relative path, I mean this dot dot. So that you can start from where you are and you can go up to go down or where again. So you go around. You don't have to always start from the beginning. You can go one up and then move further down. Okay, next things. File permissions. So, don't worry, you will get the exercise so you can have fun and solve them all by tomorrow. So, we've talked already about this ls-l. And it's when you do this in a typical directory, this is what you're going to see. So you see the name of the files, when they were created, how big they are. Typically, a directory is four kilo. So that's typical size of a directory. That's in order to store the content of a directory. Sometimes you can have very little files. If it can be even zero, you can have a file with size zero. There's no problem. And then here you have basically in which group you are and who you are. And then we have this thing. I didn't talk too much about it, but it was there already since we used the ls command. And this basically gives you what you can do with the file, or what the group, the members of your group can do with the file, or what everybody else can do with the file. And so basically, it's divided like you have here in 3x3, starting from the back, and one in front. The first one is to see which type of file it is. If it's nothing, it's a simple file. If it's a D, it means it's a directory. You have some more exotic things, but I will not go into details about these because then it's on sort of shared file systems and so on. But that goes too far. Anyway, you will never see this on your computer. And then we have the first triplet, an R, W, X. R means, if you look only at the first triplet, here. R means you can read it. W means you can write it or overwrite it. X means you can execute it. For directory, you always have the X because if you remove the X for directory, you cannot browse in the directory anymore. It's not that the directory is destroyed or whatsoever, it's just it it lost a feature which makes it not working anymore. The second triplet that you will see is again an R, a W, and an X. And that means those are the rights for the group. So this particular file here, for instance, it can be read by student 1, it can be written by student 1, it can be read by the group, but it can also be read by everybody else. So basically the three triplets is the rest of the world. If you share a file on your system, make sure that either the other person is in the same group as you, or make sure it's readable for the whole world, for everybody. Of course, in terms of security, this can be an issue, because if you make everything you have, typically, for instance, your home directory, if you make it readable, writable, and executable for everybody, means everybody who comes on your computer can actually access your files. Everybody. So again, make sure that you set those things right. Here, typically, in this directory, so it's readable, writable, and executable, so you can browse in it for student 1. People from the same group here, of this class, they can all read what the content is of this directory, they can browse it, but they cannot write anything in the directory. They cannot put another file. And that's the same for you. And you can change, of course, you can change all those settings. And you can do it in two different ways. So typically here, we create a file, which is called file. So you do an echo of this in this file, so that means this file contains the word test. If you do an ls-l, you will see the details. So given it doesn't contain much, it's tiny. And those are the default rights. Basically, because you created it, it's readable and writable for you. And by default, it's most of the time readable by the group and others. Those are settings linked to the systems, so that can sometimes be different. This, for instance, when you see a file is owned by root, in the group root, then you know that it's a file that is owned by the system. That means that nobody else but the system can modify it. Even you cannot modify it, except if you would have root and therefore administrator rights. Also, typically, in order to prevent that anything would be installed in those in the directories where the system is installed, it will not be writable for anybody but root. So that means that if you want to install a new software, you will need to give it the root password in order to be able to install the software. And it's simply because this has been set. If this was not set here, everybody would be able to install any software, which is again is a risk problem and something that viruses would love, because then they can get anywhere where they want. But also, of course, if you're sharing files and sometimes your file needs only to be readable, writable for yourself, but then at some point you want to share it with someone else, certainly if it's on a server where you share the same file system, you have the command shmot from change mode. And you can do it in two different ways. And the most convenient way is to do it in a symbolic way. And this is by actually combining the letters U, G, O, or A, a plus or a minus, and then R, W, or X, and the name of the file. So typically, you have your file that was created in the previous slide, the tiny little file. If you do shmot G plus W of that file, you will see that basically at this position, so for the group, a W will be added. So suddenly your file becomes writable for your group. Here, it's for others. Here you can use the O or the A. So others means that It will be for the third triplet of characters, so you will add a W here. If you put an A, it will basically make it for everybody, for you, for the group, and for the others, all together. So that's what the A means. And certainly when you want to share a file for which you put somewhere on, which is accessible through web, for instance, make sure it is readable for all, because otherwise the person will not be able to read it and therefore not be able to retrieve the file. You can also combine the different things. So here you can say, I want to make the file for everybody, readable, writable, and executable, and suddenly everything will be filled in. And then there's a more nerdy way to do it. It's by adding numbers. So basically, it's the binary way of doing it. It's a bit of a nerdy way, but okay. So read corresponds with the number 4, and in binary it's given this way, number 2 is this way, number 1 is this way. So those are the binary codes, and if you want to change the mode of the file, you can actually combine this. So basically you want to make it readable plus writable for the first group, so for yourself. You want to make it only readable for the group and only readable for the others. And then that means that it's 6-4-4. And then you put the number 6-4-4, and then you can do a schmaltz 6-4-4 and to modify this one. Of course, it requires a little bit of calculations, but I prefer to use the symbolic way. It's sort of easier to do, but definitely it's the same thing. Here again, 7, so that means you have a 4, a 2, and a 1. 7 is the largest number you can have. And then you put a 5, and that means a 4 and a 2, so it's readable and executable, and that's just what you have here. So, those are the two ways. Also directories, you can change those permission. If you put it in a readable, it means that you can put files, it means that the files that you put in the directory will be readable by others. If you put it in write, it means that others, people from your same group or others can actually add files to the directory. Again, important when you collaborate with people. And execute is always needed because in order to be able to browse in the directory, you need to have this execute permission set on. Of course, all those permissions will allow people to, other people than you, to maybe add files, but also to delete files. So if you want to share files and make sure that they don't delete it, make sure that they're readable for the others and not necessarily writable, then you will not have the surprise that someone basically moved the file out of your directory instead of copying it or something. What you can also do is change the owner of the file. On your local PC, that should be no problem. On higher end computers, that might be a bit of a problem. This is done by change owner. And here you say that you want to the current file, called file, you want it to change to the owner, student 2. So originally the file was owned by student 1. By now giving it the ownership to the student 2, the rights that were linked to the file will be transmitted to student 2. You can also change user and group by using a colon in between the two. And then if you do this, from now on, the file will be owned by root in the group of root. And as soon as you do that, given that you're not a root, you won't be able to change it back. because only the owner of the file can give the ownership to someone else. Except, of course, the administrator of the root, he has more rights, he can basically give ownership to of one file, which is not his own, to someone else. Then, in order to do this, in order to share files, for instance, to change owners, you have another command, which is called groups. And groups will tell you to which groups you belong to. On your laptop, typically, you will belong to a single group, maybe a few more, but only for system reasons you might have. But if you work on a larger system, like typically our system back in Belgium, this is a colleague, and this colleague is in the group Biocom, so biocomputing. He's also in the group class, because he needs to be able to be in the class. He has actually on the system where he was logged in, he also has administrator rights. He's also collaborating with the people working on the Poplar genome. He has access to the SQL servers, and then to some other projects things like here, for instance, dev, that's for developing, and this is basically a place where we put local BLAST databases, so that you can also read the BLAST databases that were installed by the administrators. And given that you know the group for this particular person, you can also do change group, and this way this person can own a file, and instead of sharing, for instance, with Biocom, he can transfer his sharing with the group BITS, and from then on, basically only the people from BITS will be able to access it, and it will not be shared with the people from BITS. Is that clear, or am I losing people? And also, with the minus R, you can do it in a recursive way. Basically, if you have a complex system with different paths, directories, and you put your files at some places, or you were working on a certain project and you had in a certain directory and you had some files there, and then, I don't know, you had something else to do, another project, exams for 2 months. Basically, you didn't look at it. And you totally forgot where you put your files. Then you have this utility, find, basically to help you finding back your files. Sometimes it's very useful when you're working on different projects. And typically, you have a path, some selection criteria, and then you can even do something with what you found. And here, to give you an example, you want to look in this particular directory, something that has the name, and we put it between quotes here because we want to use this wildcard. And basically, we want all the files that have the extension GZ. And once you find it, you want to print it, and then from the previous session, the pipe, basically, and we have another command which says head, and we said -5, and that means, so basically look for all those files, print them out, and to the screen, and only show me the top 5. And this is what you're gonna get. So here again, we combine find and head. This is the pattern that we're looking for, and that's the action that you want to have. Actually, the action print is the default. So if you don't put print, it will anyway come to the screen. You can go something further. Here we only show the top 5, but how many files are there actually which are compressed in that particular directory? Well, in that particular directory, there were 11,000 files. Again, we combine different commands with each other here. Also, very convenient is that you can look for certain types of files. You want to look for a file, a directory, a symbolic link. This is like a shortcut, like you have in Windows, a shortcut. You can also look for files that have specific permissions. Basically, only the files that are readable and writable for you, for yourself, for instance. But be careful, and that's why with the schmod command, I showed you the example with the numbers. Here you have to use those numbers. So here you cannot use the symbolic way. So this can be 000 or 75, whatever numbers. So those are the numbers that we saw just before. You can also look for only the files of a certain user. So basically your files. You don't want to look for the other files from someone else. Files from a certain group. You can even look for files that are larger than a certain size. It's here in blocks, which is a number of bytes, but that's not so. That's basically a little bit of a detail. But anyway, you can, if you have a directory and you want only to look at the biggest files, you can look at the biggest, look for the biggest files. Also, if you're playing with files and you want to find the one that you last modified, so the most recent version of a file, then you can see which one was modified in less than so many days or accessed in no more than so many days. So those are all sort of little options that you have that allows you to fine-tune your searching of your files. Here an example, if you type actually, and you can do it on your system, although you will probably not have files of this, but play a little bit around. So look for files in the current directory, type F, so only files, no directories, with the permission, readable, writable, and executable for everybody. And check this a little bit and change it also. Take a 7, like let's say 744 or something like that. Or a 644. And then you will find probably more files. Here, an example with the modifying time, so 2 days ago. Less than 2 days ago, actually, with the minus. Also, when you look for files that were modified a year ago, or the last year, you can actually put the number of days. And this way you will look at files that have not been accessed, for the last year. Sort of a good way to clean up your system if needed. If you didn't access them for many years, maybe those files were not so useful. Well, don't do this on those files, because those are system files, but your personal files. And here we have some more examples. For instance, we're looking for a file in the current directory that was accessed the last 2 days, but not longer than 5. And just list them and give only the top 10. Well, here I've put only the top 5 because it didn't fit on my slide. But actually, you can go quite complex things. For instance, here, you look in this directory for a file with that begins with an L. And then once, for all those files that you find, you actually copy them to another directory. So you can really make quite complex things using the find. But again, you can also pipe it and accounts and so forth. symbolic links, that's also something which is quite useful. The command is ln minus s to make a symbolic link, so, and that's to make shortcuts in the Unix system. That's very useful if you want, if you have a certain big files and they're sitting somewhere in a certain directory, but instead of having to type the path to that file all over again and again, you might make a symbolic link to the directory where you're working, and this way it is as if the file was in a directory, but like a shortcut works, whatever changes you make will affect the original file. Except removing. If you remove a symbolic link, you only remove the link. You don't remove the file. We're using it's quite true. Also, if you're working with lots of files, you have projects, and your project is done, your paper is written, and the data is basically you're not going to work on it anymore, then you might want to put it away, to archive it. And the most common command to use is tar. And the file resulting from this, we call it a tarball. And it's a bit like a zip file. When you click a new Windows system or macOS, you click on a couple of files and you say, well, archive them. It will make a file that contains the files and compress them. And here we need the command tar. And tar, you have the options typically C to create an archive, X is to extract the archive, and T is to display the contents of an archive. F is to specify the name of the archive, and then minus V is actually to sort of verbose, so that means it will tell you whatever it does, it will be printed on the screen step by step. So basically that means that in order to create a tarball, you use the command tar, you create, you verbose it, and you name, you give it the tarball a certain name, which is here test.tar, and we put basically everything in here. Because a little thing that an error that happens very often is that you put a space between your wildcard star and a fixed part. So basically, if the star is there all by itself, surrounded by spaces, it means everything. But of course, it means that file will be also already in there. So also, there little mistakes, little typos can affect quite your system. Then once you create it, because you put a star, basically everything will be put in there. Then you can see how big it is. You can here extract it again with the X. You extract the file again, and this way you get everything back again as it was before. But tar doesn't compress. It just makes a binary combination of all the data, all the files that you have in there. And you can put text files, binary files, anything can go in the tarball. If you want to, this is to test. So basically the minus T, and it will list you everything in detail, how big they are, and so forth, in the tarball. But if you want to have a compressed file, you need to use a tool called gzip. There are more tools. So gzip is the most common one, most predominantly used. There's also pzip2 and other compression programs that will compress more or less, depending. But gzip is really the most common one. It compresses well enough, and Also, it's quite fast. That's quite important. It's quite fast. And so, for instance, you have a big file. It's 30 megabytes. If you use the gzip, typically it will sort of reduce it by one third the size of your file. And then, what else do we have? Then there's one thing here, but I will come back to this. So this is sort of the black hole in the Unix system. If you direct something to this, it vanishes, it disappears. So this is like the sort of trash place where you can trash everything, it will be destroyed. So be cautious when you direct something to that thing. But I'll come back to this later. So as tar cannot compress, you have to tell tar to use gzip in order to compress. And this is by adding the option Z. Z. So by adding this option, it will know that you will have to compress once the tar file has been created. And typically it will have this extension. Here, again, as I said before, the extension per se doesn't mean anything in a Unix system, but it's sort of, well, people use as a default the extension GZ to tell people, other people that this file was compressed with GZ. The tar ball, and then the tar ball was created. So this is more for info than rather for the system to know what sort of file it is. And then you can decompress again with gzip by using the minus C option or by using a shortcut which is called simply unzip. Yeah, zip, gzip and g unzip. Simple. Then one thing you shouldn't neglect is that as many people use Unix or Windows, more people use Windows, but also Mac, is that files in are coded in a different way. Typically, if you have a file in a Windows system, the end of a line in your file will be coded by a return and a new line. In the Unix system, it's only new line. And actually, in Mac, it's line, it's slash L and slash N. So, but that means that those extra characters, and those are hidden characters. So if you open the file in a Word document, you don't see those things. It's simply coded by the formatting of the file in a DOS or Windows system. But if you have such extra characters, basically if you get this file from someone, for instance, that was working on Windows or who downloaded the file or did something with Windows, save it and then sends it to you and you want to use it on your Unix system, you have to clean it up. And for this you have two commands, Unix to DOS, or you have also Mac to DOS, and the reverse, DOS to Unix or Mac to Unix. And this will basically only do those little conversions. And I can tell you how important it is that if you write a pro little script and someone opened it with a simple text editor in Windows, made a little modification, whatever, saves it back in Windows and sends it back to you, you will not be able to run it anymore. Simply because you have this hidden character in there. So very often, if a script that was working before and you know that someone touched it and it doesn't work anymore, most of the time it's just this. And it even has repercussions on if you have large files, like a big tabular file that was generated in Excel. You save it, you save the file in Excel in a tabular format, it will have those extensions. If you parse it using a Perl, basically it will have too much information here and will not parse it properly. And that will basically can mess up your whole program, because each time it will find this extra character that doesn't fit what you're supposed to find. Given that more and more you're working, or you will be working in the future, with large files, huge data, and gigabyte, 1 gig is actually not that big. A typical FASTQ file, when you do sequencing, will be 5-6 gigabytes compressed, which is enormous. So if you uncompress it, you might end up with even bigger files. And you cannot process them in other windows because they're simply too big. And the software, most of the software that you currently have on your system is not made to handle this size of files. And it can happen that basically they corrupt your data. So try to avoid it as much as possible. Also, what we see typically, when people are looking at expression data and they have a big Excel sheet, and up to a couple of years, for instance, not so long time ago, Excel could only handle, what was it, 65,000 lines? And whatever was behind that number was just ignored, truncated. Piece of your data was gone. So you have to be careful. Nowadays, Excel can handle more lines, but still, it's not like infinite. So you will always end up with a boundary that, and it will discard. Also, what we also see regularly is that people that are handling those big tables, and they want to sort them according to certain values in a certain column. If they don't take care to select all the columns in the Excel sheet and they do a sort, basically the correlation between the different columns is gone. And if you save it, you cannot undo it anymore. It's gone. Basically, you lose all the information, all the correlations. So if you use Excel, be careful. Be very careful, and rather use Unix commands, or even better, scripting language like Perl and Python. So having said that, let's first do stuff, see what we can do on text files with Unix commands. Typically, one thing which is kind of nice is the sort command. And you have different options. Again, you can sort according to and for numeric values. You can do a reverse order, you can remove duplicates, and you can select or sort according to a certain column. And you can combine different columns together. The advantage is there that it will always look at your data as one line, as one record. It will not change one column and leave the other columns untouched. So this is a much safer way to sort your big data files. It will not mess up your data. Here, a couple of examples. Suppose you have a file called sort2, and this is the list of numbers that you have in there. If you do simply sort on that particular file, it will do an alpha numeric sorting, which means 1 comes before 0, comes before 0 comes before 1, 1 before 2, 3 before the rest. But that means that you will have this order, so not a numerical sorting. If you add the minus n option, it will sort it properly in numerical values. And also the output is in a column. I've put it here horizontally simply to have everything on the slide, but normally the output is vertically. So you can also remove here duplicates, so the ones, the two ones will be removed. And you can, if you have another file which contains two columns, you can actually sort it according to a column again. So here we want to sort it in the reverse order, numerically, on column 2. And this is what we will get. But what you also can do is that with the command cut is to actually extract a subset of the columns that you have in your file. Suppose you have a huge file with hundreds of columns and you just need three columns of the whole file. Basically with cut you can do this. Suppose you have a file here, and here we have the top four, the command head, top four of this file. This is what we get, three columns only, and we have here data in this. If we do the command cut and we say here, instead of a K like column, it's F for field. So we only want to have the first column, field 1, of this file, and we also list only the top 5, top 4 of that list. You will find basically only those numbers. If we do on the same file, we want to see only the third column, and we want to sort it beneath. Actually, it will not work, and it will not work because here the default separator in files is tab. So the default should be a tab characters, tab symbol, and here we separated the files with a semicolon. So here this will not work. If you add the minus d and say the delimiter is semicolon, then it will work. And you actually can use select as here, shown here, more than one file, more than one column. And here typically we have column 1 and column 3 extracted from this. So this way you can easily select the columns that are of interest to you. Another very much used command is grep. Grep allows you to use certain patterns. Basically, if you have a huge file and you want to look in that file, so it's a bit like find, but here, like find looks for a file, grep will look in the file for something. And you can use quite extensive patterns. You can use regular expressions. I don't know if you heard about regular expressions before, but this is more than just a star and a question mark. It's more than just wildcards. You can tell, for instance, that you want to have some numbers at certain position in a certain line, and so forth. So for instance, here we have this file, tab delimited, three columns, and this is what it contains. If you do a grep between quotes of sequence 1 of this particular file, it will only give you the lines that contain the information that you're looking for. Typically, you have, again, a big Excel sheet with expression data. You have whatever, 50,000 lines, and you want only to find the expression of a single gene, which is called something, X. Basically, you can do a grep on this whole file to find that particular line without having to go through the whole thing. You can also ask, basically, if there's something you want to know, you have to see the whole file, but you need to find on which line sequence 1 occurs. In this way, you will have an extra column appearing telling you will find this, the search term on line number 1, number 3, and number 6. You can also count how many times a certain pattern occurs with the minus C. So it will tell you it occurs 3 times. And you can also ask to ignore the case of the search pattern. So here, if you put the minus I, and even though you put it in big characters, minuscules, also minuscules will come out of your search. So here again, you can do quite extensive searching, and it goes further, because if you use the, and I didn't put it here, the minus P option, you can actually use Perl regular expressions. And those are very flexible and allow quite extensive searches. There's one thing though you have to take care of. If you do a grep on a very big file, it can actually choke your system. If you have a 5 gig file and you do a grep on this, it will start to make indices in memory, and basically it might kill or slow down your system quite dramatically. So here there's some limitations. And if a grep becomes too slow, you better go to Perl or Python and start to program a little bit with data structures. So regular expressions and a little intro on what you can do with regular expressions is, for instance, with this little headline character, means something at the beginning of the line. So you have a file and you look for something at the beginning of the line. With a dollar sign, you say something at the end of the line. A dot here is any character, and a star is, you can combine it with a dot, is to say zero or more occurrences. If you use, in this context, you use a question mark, it's like one or zero occurrence. And then between square brackets, you can put a number of characters that you want to have present at a certain position. So if you look for all the files that have an A and a B, or one and a two, or something like that at a certain position, you can put it between square brackets and both files will be, both lines will be returned. Suppose, here another example, suppose we have this file and we grep the pattern sec in this file, it will return all those things. So, second, because it's part of every one of these lines. If we refine it, we put this character here at the beginning, only those will come out of the search. If we do it with something else, it's those files. If we put the dollar, it's only the ones that terminate with the one that will be returned. Again, here, those files that terminate with a 1 or a 2 at the end will come out. 1, 2, 3 will come out, but you can also do it in a more symbolic way, like 1 up to 3, and then it will also return the same thing as the 1 above. For instance, you have sequences. We're doing bioinformatics, so we're dealing with biological sequences. And you want to find all the sequences that have this, those nucleotides, A, T, G, C, in their sequence. And well, it will return all the sequences that have all the lines on which you have a sequence that have this pattern. So here you have it here, and here you have it in the middle. And with the minus N again, you can say on which line in the original file you can find it. Or you can say how many times a sequence has this sort of pattern. Can be done. And then something that is also quite often used, but a bit complex, is awk. Awk is sort of a one-line scripting language. And typically, it starts with the command fork, some options, some selection criteria, and then some actions and the input file. Like here, I have two things. So here, basically, with print, so you do the action, it's just simply reading the file. This is exactly the same as simply reading the file. And here, actually, you indicate with the $1 or $2, $3, and so forth, which column. So it's a little bit like the command to cut in this case. Here it will only output you column 1 of the file. Some more, because here you can do some more elaborated things. Basically, you want that column 1 should be smaller than 5. If you find it, print it. This is what you get. You want column 1 to be larger than 3. This is what you will get. You want column 1 to be larger than 3, but smaller than 100. And this and so forth. You can also look for some matching patterns, so CE1. Or combine it with a numerical selection and a textual selection, and so forth. And so you can make quite complex search criteria in a file. Okay, so some more with files. There are, as you could see with piping and redirecting and so forth, there's three ways how to do it. Typically, you have the standard input, which is the input file. So this is typically with the bigger than sign, if you would use it. You have the standard out, which is typically the output. And then you have the standard error, which is typically for error messages. From everything that you do in Unix, you can capture any one of those. Well, the input, of course, this is what you do. But the numbers here in the back actually tells you what you want to have. And it can be interesting because sometimes you have some files that create some errors and you want to capture them in order to sort of debug or see what's going wrong. And as you saw in the previous slide, number 2 is for the error. So if you say to actually, you execute a certain thing, like here, foo, this file doesn't exist. If you want to capture this and not only have it on your screen, you can, when you redirect it to a file that you call error, and you put a 2 in front of it, it will capture the error stream. So this way you can capture errors along a whole set of operations that go along, and for each command you can this way capture and have a log file of all possible errors. If no errors occur, this file will be empty. So typically, suppose you have a little verb program here, and what it does is print this. In Perl, you can this 0, 1, and 2, you can also code it symbolically, which is a bit more appealing, I would say, standard error. And this is basically what it should print as standard error. So if we run this little Perl program, it will print to the screen this and this. But now if we want to run it and capture this, what is printed to the screen, and we want to put it in a file, like in the file res, if you do it this way, it will only output, this will be in the file, standard error. It will output something in there, and the other thing, which is printed out, will be printed on the screen. So that comes on the screen, and the rest goes in the file. If you do it with the number 2, actually, what was supposed to go to the standard out will be printed to the screen, and only the error will be captured in the file called error. So this way you can split, actually, the output. You can have, for instance, the normal output, sort of verbose, that goes to the screen, and or it goes to a certain file, and whatever is error can be redirected to another file, so that you don't have the two streams mixed into each other. And you can actually do this in several ways, like here. Here you capture the standard out that goes in this file, and the standard error goes into this one. And this way you can capture everything. So the content of the file res will be this, the content of the file error will be this one. And if you do it this way, then basically the two streams will end up in the standard error file. If you do it this way, both standard error and standard out will end up in some output. So basically you can still redirect those streams in order to be joined if needed. And then I told you already about the black hole, so death node. So basically in the very beginning I told you about death. So death is wherever hard disk, USB stick, whatever memory thing is being listed. And one of them is null. And null means nothing in computers. And basically that means that's the sort of the black hole. Whatever you write to this will disappear, will vanish, like in a black hole. So if you redirect something to a def null, it will disappear. And sometimes it's useful, honestly. Suppose you have a Perl program and it can produce a lot of info to the standard error and or to standard out, whatever, and you don't care. But it's, by default, it will print a lot of things to the screen. And you don't want all this info to be printed to the screen. Then you can redirect it to the black hole. The software will do as if it's writing to the screen or to the file. So it doesn't care, it doesn't change anything for the software. But basically, you avoid having a huge error file or a huge log file that might fill your system. And sometimes when you do an assembly and you have so much verbosity because of the software, and it basically you don't want to have it because you know it's a routine thing and you know it works. Basically, you can redirect this to this black hole and it will not basically jam your system. And given that you have those two streams, you can put one stream to the black hole and keep the other and vice versa. Something else which is also useful on a Unix system is the command ps, processes. If you do ps, typically with the action aux, it will list you all the programs that are running on your system. So if you have your system up and running, just type the ps space aux, and it will give you a list of everything which is running on your computer. And you will be maybe surprised at how much is actually running on your computer. And here, again, you will see the user. So root, that's the system. If you're running something, you will see your nickname here. Process ID, this is sort of the unique number that identifies your job. How much CPU is it's using? Typically, if your computer is slowing down and you type this, you will see on the top line the software that is using the most CPU or most of the memory, and this might be the program that is basically slow down your whole system and you might think about killing it. Then you have some other parameters like here, whether it's interactive or not. Whether it is sleeping, or dead, or zombie, if you have a Z. It's a zombie job, which means it's actually a job which is there, as if it's running, but it's not doing anything anymore. So it's sort of dead without being really dead. That's why we call it zombie. How much time it's running already, and then what's already the name of the job that they're running. So if you have a job that is taking too much resources, you might want to kill it. So therefore you have the kill command. You can kill pretty much everything, except, well, everything which is owned by you. You cannot kill other people's processes. That would be sabotage otherwise. But in order to use a kill command, you use this ps out, and then you will have this identifier, and based on this identifier, you can use and kill a certain process. And as I said, if it's not yours, you cannot kill it. So here, I tried to kill the process 16,524, but 16,524 is owned by the system. So basically, the operation is not permitted. If I kill my own process, here the 44, which is a connection to a server, basically I kill that connection and it says that the whole connection is closed. This way you also have, again, you have much more control of what is going on in your system. Another way to monitor a little bit your system is to use the command stop. And suppose you have here a blast command line running, so it's a protein running on a protein database, so it's a blast P. And then we do a top on our system, and here, typically, if you do a top now on your computer, you will see that you get quite a lot of information. So here, for instance, how long the system is running. So here you see it's already 13 days it's running. This is the average load. So this one, this number, you don't want to have it too high, not higher than the number of CPUs or cores that we have in our system. How many jobs are running? Well, are in the list here. Only one is actively running. The rest is sleeping. And see, you have 5 zombie jobs. And then here you see how much of your CPU is being used in percent-wise, and how much memory is available in total and is being used. And the swap is typically something that you have on a Unix system also, and actually on all operating system, is for to use as an extension of your memory. You use a little piece of your hard disk. This allows you to store temporarily less used data and files, but it slows down your system. So if you see that this number becomes very high, means that your computer doesn't have enough memory, and it starts to use your hard disk as an extension of your memory, and that slows down your system enormously. And so typically, as I'm running here a blast, you see that my top job here is a blast. It uses 86% of the CPU, 3% of the total memory, and it's job number 24512, and it's already running here for just a very short time because it just started up. And then one thing is that if you have this command line, here you see this symbol, the ampersand. This is to send a job in the background. And by sending a job in the background means that the job will run, but you will be able to keep the terminal window active. Because normally, as long as an operation is running, you cannot do anything else. You have to wait until the job is done in that particular window. If you do it this way, basically it sends, the command is sort of, you let it loose on the system, it will run, no problems, and you will keep the control over the terminal. You can play with this if you have a job which is in the background and you want to bring it to the foreground. You have a command FG to bring it back to the foreground. Sometimes can be useful in order to see what's going on. On the reverse, if you didn't put this ampersand symbol and you said okay, now it can go in background, you can use the command BG and it will disappear in background and you will gain control. In order to do that, although you need first to suspend the program and then you can do the BG. So you said, oh, wait a second, and then say go to background and then it works then. And then, yeah, this is not so much. So some things here, again, I'm running this blast and I redirect the output to this result file. Everything seems to run fine and I decide to put it in background. So I do Control Z, the combination Control Z on the keyboard. It will tell you I stopped everything. If you say jobs, it will actually tell you the same thing. So the job was stopped. If you say foreground FG, it will basically take again control over the terminal window. If you do the Control Z again, you will pause it again. If you do BG, it will be set basically as if it adds the symbol and it's been sent to background. And if you do jobs, the command jobs, it will tell you that it's still running, although you have control over your terminal. Nano is a little text-based editor that you can use. So it's useful if you want to have a more normal or a way to look at the text files. So Nano is one, which also comes with a menu. You have other things like VI, but that's, I will not show here because then you don't have a menu or something like me by heart. So, yeah, a little bit of things. Okay, this one you cannot do because you don't have last image.
For this afternoon, we'll do a little bit more on Unix shell and a little bit some close to programming things, although you will not have to be able to program at the end of the session. But I will give you some introduction to some basics. So with Unix, actually when you start, when you have your terminal, you always have what we call a shell. And this shell is basically your minimal environment that you have running in your terminal. And it will determine how you have to sort of format a number of things in your system. So and it has also some configurations in order to be able to tell the system where some software are installed and so forth. And to give you an example, you have two, and also the system environment from the shell will always have variables, and variables always start with a dollar sign, and they will always be in capital. This is something like a sort of a convention in when you have a shell. So if you would, in your terminal, type this, you would see what sort of shell is currently in your terminal. So depending on versions and software, it might be TCSH or it might be Bash. So I think with Cygwin you will have Bash. And depending on the version of Windows that you have, of Mac that you have, it will be either TCSH or Bash also. So this way you have an idea of which shell you have running. But you can always change those. If you rather have another one, there's no problem. You can always do this. And then another quite important variable that you have in your shell is path. Path basically is the variable which contains, for instance, something like this, and more importantly, the directories in which you have the applications to the software. A shell will always look in this variable to see which directories it has to, in which directories it has to search for the executables. Because you don't want each time you type a command, certainly if you have a very large hard disk with lots of data and lots of directories, that your whole system needs to actually screen all the paths, all the possible paths on your system in order to find a command. So therefore, if you type this, echo $path, you will see all this same list separated with a colon of all the paths, and this is where your software is supposed to be installed. So those are the environment variables. But if you want, you can also make your own variables. Like if you would declare something like this at the command line, and right after do this, basically it will output the word test. So do echo $myvar, enter, and it will give you this as output. Another environmental variable that you normally have, should have, is env. And basically that one will list everything which is below. So it gives you all the details of your system, like what's the name of your computer, what software you're running, which sort of shell you have, etc., your username, the path is there again, your current directory, etc., which language you're using, and so forth, and so forth. So also if you have a connection, it will be listed there. And if you look for something for your system, it's sort of an easy way to find it. Another command is the set, and this one, if you type set, will give you again a number of settings basically that are directly linked with the shell that you're using. The previous one was more linked to the system, and this one is really linked to the particular shell that you're using. And for instance, there are things like, even where I saw somewhere, which colors to use, etc. Here, which colors to use in order to see the different colors of your different files. Okay, so the first one will not work for you, but you can use maybe another executable. So this command here, which, will tell you where a certain software is. So instead of doing the blast all, do something like ls. So do which ls, and then it will tell you where ls is supposed to be. If you do the same thing here, actually you will have the same output as written here, because blast all is not installed on your system. You won't be able to actually find it. So which will not be able to find it, and you will have this to say that it's basically not installed. I will not go too much detail because this is a bit too much around the blast software itself. So, and I don't think it's a good idea to start installing blast on your system now. But in general, shell is also a sort of programming language. And because of that, it allows you to make some things automatic. So to make, instead of having to type each time different commands, you can put them all in a script, in a little text file, and then ask the system, the shell, to actually execute what's in the text file. And this way it will do all those different steps one after the other. and you will have only to execute one thing. So basically, this way you sort of build your own little commands that will use shell commands. So it's very handy to automate things when you're looping and those kind of things. And this is actually what we're gonna look a little bit at in the coming slides, is how we can sort of loop through data and loop through files. So as it is not a compiled language, it's an interpreted language, it will be always readable and available, so it's always open source. And it's quite interesting because you can easily make little modifications and then to sort of run something similar. So I would, so normally, can you check whether you have the, I didn't check that actually, if you have the editor called Nano. Can you type Nano on in your terminal? Do you have it? I think the Mac users might not have it. They do? Okay, the Mac users have it. Do the Cygwin users have it? No. What could you have and on the Cygwin? No, but Notepad is on the Windows. Okay, so if you use Notepad, think about this morning that Notepad is a DOS Windows, DOS program, and then you need the DOS to Unix. Problem, again, DOS to Unix is not a standard software which is installed on your system. Do you have VI? If you type VI. Okay, well, we'll try with the Notepad in Windows. So open a Notepad and basically create this file. And it contains, so forget about this cut. Just create a file with this name and contains those three lines. So echo $1, echo $2, echo $3, and save it. Save it somewhere and remember where you save it, because you will need the path to that file. But make sure that this file is somewhere at least for the Windows users, that it's located, that you have a path to that file. So if you save it on your desktop, it will be quite a long path to go to. So save it really at maybe at the very root of your Windows, if you have access. But if the Mac user is already, normally it should give you this as an output. Is that okay? For the Mac users it works? Okay, I will have to make sure that we have something for the Cygwin users. Okay, so basically the whole thing here is that if you make a shell script and it contains those little things, the $1 is actually for the first variable, $2 the second variable, $3 for the third variable. That means that you can make a little shell script which is quite general, and you're able to pass parameters to that particular shell script. So that makes it more convenient if you want to run a number of things. And typically what you have in shell scripts is a couple of specific variables that are linked to this whole shell, and that is the $0, which will give you the name of the script, so basically this. The dollar number will give you, well, dollar dash will, what is it called again, this thing? Well, this thing will give you the number of arguments, and this will give you basically the string with all the arguments. And so those are variables that you can also use in your shell scripts later on when you want to make some more specific things. So if, that's in this case it won't work. What should work for everybody are those things. So you can also make calculations in your shell scripts, although it's not so elaborated calculations. But if you use the command exp a space, and then you have to delimit the whole all the important characters with a space, except for the star. There you need to move the backslash, because otherwise star is will be interpreted as a wild card, and that's not what you mean. So in this way you can make calculations, little calculations in your shell script, which can be sometimes convenient. It's the same order as in mathematics. So basically, multiplication and division goes before sum and subtraction. And so if you would do this in a little shell script, you basically could have something like this. And you can make it even more elaborated. If you add the $1 and $2, for instance, you can start to make a little scripts that make little calculations for you. One little thing is also this. This is the back tick. So I don't know on which key this is on your keyboard. So it's not the simple single tick. It's the tick in another direction. So it's not going like this. It's going like this. So it should be hidden somewhere on your keyboard. And the thing is, what you put between those back ticks will be executed, and the output will be put in a variable then. And this way, you can make calculations and save the output of those calculations in order to do something else with it. So you can do some basic calculations. Also, when you want to make a shell script, you always want to check things. Check conditions and or if something is successful or if some output exists, for instance, then for this you have the if, then, else, and fi, or depending on shell, it's also and if that you can have. And this is to actually check, make some checks, so that if a file is present, do this, for instance. This is what is important. And the synopsis of this is the same in all languages. You might have some slight differences, like this fi or endif is not present in all languages, but basically for the rest, the if then else, this is always present. And here, for instance, you have an example. So if I do a grep of FTP in this file, if I find it, if it's true, then you say FTP found, otherwise you say FTP not found. And so if you make a little shell script that contains all this, you can then run it and it will, for instance, give you an output like this. So this is how it works. You also have a number of operations that you can do, like you have the minus EQ for equal to, NE not equal to, etc. And you can then use this in your shell script. This is for comparing numbers, and this is for comparing strings. So double equal means that if those two strings are the same, then here you can say that those are equal. So the equivalent would be to do it this way, with square brackets instead of doing the test keyword here. And this way you can also test if two variables have the same content or are the same. That are very often used, and actually even more than what we've seen before, like this minus F, and only do something if the file exists. If it doesn't exist, there's no point in doing something. So then you can give to your little script shell script, a way to say, well, I didn't find the file, and that if your script is not running, that at least you get some feedback why it didn't run. Here to test if it's readable, writable, executable, or if it's a directory. And here to see whether the file is bigger than zero. So if you're running something and you want to make sure that you have an output, for instance, you look whether the word file occurs in the text, and if so, you will echo that dollar file. If nothing comes out, it will nothing give you no output at all. Here, for instance, we have those, and if you would give to this shell script that contains this thing, it will output you something like this. The other loop structure is while. So while a certain variable has a certain value, here in this case greater than zero, you will loop through this. So here again, you have the expression and the little backtick. You start with the value 5. So 5 is bigger, is greater than zero. So you can enter the loop. And then in the loop, what you do is you give the number of the file, of the variable. You calculate the next one, so you subtract 1. And then you go back here. So you basically, when you start, it comes in as 5. You take minus 1, 4, 3, 2, 1, and basically you get the list like here. So this way, you can also go through a whole list of files. Of course, here it's very simple things, but suppose you have a lot of files and you need to check something, you can, for instance, as long as a certain number, you can actually combine the previous. You can have an if-then-else statement in this loop, and then for each value, it will check and test the value to see whether it's okay to go on with the next thing that you want to do. So I have a few exercises that you can do. You can try to do this, but don't bother. Don't change. Do this one here. Blast is not installed, so this one you cannot do. Here, this one you can do, and well, you can do a few, but let's do that. So now, one important thing for now, and certainly for the coming days, is accessing a remote server. So, Patricio, if I say something wrong, for the case here, just jump and say the right thing. So, typically what we're going to use is the command SSH. So SSH, oh, it's encrypted, allows you to make an encrypted connection to a remote server. So for instance, I can from here log in to the servers back in Belgium, and I can actually work on the servers back in Belgium. All thanks to all those command lines that you saw before, and this way I can run basically an assembly from here. Well, can I finish first a little bit, and then I'll do the connection, okay? So, I'll first give a little bit of explanation here. So basically with SSH, whether you're on Cygwin or on your Mac, you can connect directly to a server. And once you're on that server, basically you do everything like as if you were directly on that server. The big advantage of connecting to servers is that servers have typically more memory, more CPUs, and like Patricio said, the machine on which you can connect in the end will have 24 CPUs and you will have 32 gigs of RAM. This is something that you, for instance, don't have on your local computers in order to run. And typically, actually even 32, and I was discussing it during lunchtime with Patricio, 32 gigs of RAM is actually, for bioinformatics, not so much. It's limited. This is typically a good node for computation, so do a lot of calculus and doing a lot of computation, but as soon as you start to deal with large amounts of data, you need more memory. To give you an example, our cluster has 2 nodes with 0.5 tera of RAM, and the others have 0.25 tera of RAM, and only a few have also the 32 gigs of RAM. So the other advantage is that once you run a job, certainly on a cluster, is that you can keep it running over there. It can run for 10 days, and you don't need to have your laptop up and running for 10 days. You can keep working on your laptop as you're used to. So I've put in the command line here two things that are optional, and this is, and I don't know if it works here, but the minus X will allow you to open an X11 tunneling. X11 is actually the whole set of libraries and programs in order to draw Windows and a graphical interface in Unix. And if you allow an X tunneling through your SSH, means that you can start an graphical interface through your SSH connection, and it will show up on your screen. And actually, that means that you have another window popping up, and whatever you do in that window will actually be saved, if you save it, directly on the server. So it's like a wormhole. The P, that's if you have a certain port. In the case here for the cores, it's the default port for SSH. So that's 21 or 22, if I remember. But sometimes in order to make it a little bit more secure, you might need to connect through another port. So basically for those two options, you don't need to bother too much. And if you look with the minus H, you will again find a lot of other connections. So as Patricio put on the board here, Patricio, double check, this is right. So from here you can connect this way to a login server. This one gives connections from outside of, let's say, the network, but still you have to be in on the campus in order to be able to use it. And then once you're here on this server, once this was logged in, if you do this and it's the first time, also it will ask you to agree with a key, and it will install a little key in a hidden directory on your computer, and you have to say yes with the three letters, not just Y, but really yes. And then it will store, and it will only ask you this once, the first time you connect. Once you're on the login server, really computation, we will have to go to the compute 115, and again, you do this SSH to 115, and normally it will not ask you this question, because basically other people already accessed from this place to this place. This is the place where we can do some work. And so I have actually a little exercise. So basically do whatever, all the things that I just said. So basically connect to that computing. So this is in order to connect, if you're not connected yet. You cannot? Who has problems to connect? I'm doing it with Eduroam. So with Eduroam, I'm fine. So in the beginning, you have to have the shebang line, like we call it. So that's at the very beginning. And here again, every character is important. The options, that's up to you, but basically all those characters are important. This will tell you which shell you use, and then you can have those. And if this is there without anything behind, it's just a comment line, so a useless line, let's say. And here, for instance, we're gonna call the job test. The output stream will go to the file called test.output. The error file, in this case, we're gonna put in the same file, but you can put, instead of output, you can put error, for instance. Then you can put your email address to say so that the system will send you an email once it's ready. you send, here you say that everything needs to be sent, and here you request 5 hours runtime. This is not an easy parameter to set, and I don't know if you have to set it. In our system, we don't have to set it, but I don't know if you have to set it here to say in advance how long your job will run. And if you have a good idea of how long it runs, it's very interesting, because if your job is only running for 5 hours, and in the queue you have jobs that will run for 20 hours, for instance, basically your job will run before, because it will be finished before the others, and you will, in general, you will wait less time. You can also give some sort of an idea of the project here. Here, you say that you will run it on one node, and given that there's only 24 CPUs, 24 cores on the machine that you can use, please make sure that you always stipulate one node. If you say 24, you will use the whole thing, and all your colleagues in the room will not have any CPU left to work on. And then, once you've done all those little configuration, not everything is needed, but Patricio should correct me on this, but you give those configurations, and then you can start to put your little commands here. And so I made up a little exercise. So again, you will be busy for a little while. So because you're going to submit for the first time of your life a job to the cluster, and it has to do all this. So you need to take a little editor. It can be Nano, can be something else, and then try to think about the things that we talked about in this morning. So like to check the time and date, that's with the command date. You can do an echo hello world, for instance, or your name, and this will all go to the files. And correct here, this one I forgot to correct, put this as an error file instead, so that it doesn't do the two. Then you can also check what files are in the directory, in the main directory. I've put a file called, how did I call it again? I called it test.fa, so this one. Oops, you don't see it, okay. That was not. So this file, test.fa. I've put a little FASTA file here, and so it's in the main directory. You can check the top 5 processes. So if you do all this, it will all end up in this file. And then with the file that I just showed you before, try to see how many FASTA sequences are in this file, and how many of the sequences have this pattern in their sequence. And after that, I have 4 slides and it's over. So from the options, I've put all the options again. So some of them you will not need to put. I don't think this is needed. Or if you put it in like 10 minutes, because it will not take so much time. Or maybe 20 minutes, if you all are doing the same thing, the machine might be a bit slower. Make sure that you use one node, because anyway, everything that you do here is single core, so there's no need to make more than, to take more than one node. This too you need.
Okay.
I don't think you need to put this, the mail things. That's, you don't need to do this. I would put maybe 20 minutes. If you need to put, I don't know if you need to put a time, yeah. So this, you put it, this is not really needed, and this is needed to make sure that you only use one. No, this is basically, this is the whole script that will do all this. No, see, if you do it with Nano to do the search, it will, well, here it's an exact match, so here it might still work a little bit, so we can make it even a little bit more complicated.